Chicago é uma cidade cosmopolita mesmo no centro dos Estados Unidos da América. É conhecida pelos arranha-céus, mas também pelo jazz que ali chegou vindo do sul. Chicago é um sítio de cruzamentos, de misturas. Ali chegou quem vinha em busca do sonho americano, ou em busca da liberdade religiosa que os Estados Unidos sempre ofereceram a toda a gente. Foi o que aconteceu com os madeirenses errantes. Em 1848, um grupo de portugueses converteu-se ao protestantismo na Madeira. Foram obrigados a fugir da ilha. Eram centenas. Chicago foi o ponto de passagem para a cidade de Springfield, mais a sul, onde a América lhes tinha prometido guarida. O mesmo percurso vai fazer David Ferreira. Embarca no comboio com destino a Springfield. Foi a Springfield que chegaram os seus visitantes há 200 anos. Eram madeirenses e portugueses.
My brother's wife became interested in her family. And so my brother Stephen decided to start being interested in the Ferreira family. And he emailed me. He sent me an email. He said, have you seen the website that says Exiles of Madeira? And I said, no. And he sent my brother Alan the same thing. He said, when I found it, I cried. So I found it. And I was online for 2.5 hours until past midnight one night, and I was weeping because to hear the story. I didn't know the story. I'd forgotten.
Em meados do século XIX, a Madeira era uma ilha pobre, católica e ainda muito rural. Foi assim que a encontrou Robert Kelly, médico escocês e missionário protestante, quando chegou com a mulher ao Funchal. Em 1838, como médico, Kelly encantou o povo e as autoridades, mas depois começou a evangelizar os seus pacientes. A católica Madeira não gostou, a igreja reagiu violentamente e o Funchal foi palco de saques, tumultos e prisões. Em agosto de 1846, Kelly e os seus seguidores fugiram em fragatas britânicas, que estavam fundeadas ao largo do Funchal, e os levaram pelo Atlântico fora até ao arquipélago de Trinidad e Tobago. Alguns dos madeirenses protestantes viajaram apenas com a roupa que tinham no corpo. Outros levaram só as suas bíblias. Todos eles aceitaram o exílio nas Caraíbas. A maioria desembarcou em Port of Spain, a capital do arquipélago de Trinidad e Tobago, que nessa altura era uma colónia inglesa. A ilha de Trinidad vivia da economia do açúcar, que necessitava de muita mão de obra. Os escravos vinham sobretudo de África, mas quando os madeirenses chegaram à Trinidad, a escravatura acabava de ser abolida e os negros estavam já a abandonar a exploração. Os portugueses começaram por substituir os negros nos campos de cana-de-açúcar, mas durou pouco tempo esta afinal. Mal puderam, os portugueses voltaram para a cidade, estabelecendo-se em pequenas lojas. O centro de Port of Spain, que antigamente era o lugar dos imigrantes brancos, transformou-se na cidade dos negros, como tantas vezes acontece neste período. importa de Espanha os madeirenses protestantes construíram a igreja de Santa Ana.
A church was started by a Scottish doctor who was Presbyterian. He started a little congregation, and after a while, the church began to grow, and they were persecuted by the Roman Catholic Church in Madeira. But because the persecution was too much, they came to Trinidad. Trinidad was a colony of Britain, and King George III had declared that there would be religious freedom and tolerance in Trinidad. So they came to Trinidad, and they aligned themselves to the Presbyterian Church in Trinidad.
Yes, the people still think of us as Portuguese, not only myself, but my wife's family. Most of the Portuguese people who came from Madeira are still thought of as Portuguese, if not all of them. So, I think of myself as Portuguese.
It was part of the persecution of the Presbyterians in Madeira, and they had to get out very quickly. Now, a lot of Presbyterians settled here, and we have linkages in terms of other families, like the Mendez family.
They had fled from Portugal. My great-grandfather had fled from Portugal during the Inquisition because they had no freedom of worship and they wanted to listen to what was being preached. So they couldn't even take any of their possessions with them because no one could buy their home or anything else.
From what I know, his parents came out from Madeira, I think it was, and to get away from the religious upheaval. And in those days, I understand, to get the Bible out, the book of the Bible, they baked a cake. They put the Bible in the cake so that it wouldn't be found, coming in.
This was a small minority group that had fled under persecution and presumably had very little. So they were struggling to survive in a strange land.
Glória Dornelas é descendente de António Joaquim Dornelas, dos fundadores da Igreja Protestante Portuguesa em Port of Spain. Hoje, Glória é uma freira católica. É a irmã Paul, uma das autoridades mais prestigiadas da Ilha de Trinidad.
How many of you have grandparents who came from Portugal or Madeira? Particularly those who left Madeira at the time of the persecution of the Presbyterians there. Which of your grandparents came from Portugal, do you know, or Madeira?
You know, my great-grandmother.
Your great-grandmother. And was she Catholic or Protestant?
Catholic.
She was Catholic.
Why, too?
Anybody else here of Portuguese origin?
My father's mother is of Portuguese origin. Now, I don't know if she came here as a child or whether she was born here. And they are Presbyterians. They belong to churches for Grey Friars.
Right.
Anybody else?
My grandmother, whose name, her maiden name was Oliveira, Lydia Oliveira was her name. She came from Madeira, somewhere around, I think, the 1880s. She came with her father, her mother, and her sister. She claimed that her father was a sea captain, but we have nothing to verify that. But we do know that they were Presbyterian. When she married my grandfather, who was a Catholic, she then converted to Catholicism. But she lived to a very ripe old age, and she drank rum every day of life.
Recommendation for rum drinking.
Now, what was intriguing with my father's family was the close association with the Presbyterian Church. And I suppose there was an inevitability to that, so that my grandfather was considered to be virtually a Presbyterian minister. But my grandmother, who came from a very strong Catholic family, she wanted her children Catholic. So the girls were Catholic and the boys Presbyterian. And that's how they made their compromise.
No centro de Port of Spain ainda se podem ver as mansões vitorianas, casas com varandas muito trabalhadas e janelas com portadas, presenças da época colonial.
Yeah, Mr. Mendez. Yeah, this is Glenn here. All right. I am now coming up Cipriani Boulevard, so we should be by you in about 5-10 minutes for the most. Okay, sir. Bye-bye. They're so beautiful. He says, okay, thank you. Because this street we are going on to, this is where they all lived. In the olden days, this was considered outside of Port of Spain. Port of Spain is all down that way. And this is why this area is called New Town, because it was a new town being established. And this is where they lived.
A casa aldegonda era da família Mendes, que tinha vindo da Madeira e enriqueceu logo numa geração. Frederick Mendes é bisneto de António Mendes, o homem que construiu a mansão vitoriana e foi uma das grandes fortunas da ilha.
What is this, Freddy Mendes? This is fabulous.
Well, I mean, the only way to do it is to get it done.
Yeah.
Our faith, our Presbyterian faith, I believe is different to most. If I want to become a Catholic, I become a Catholic. If I want to marry a Catholic, I marry a Catholic. If I want to marry a Jew, I marry a Jew. And that's it. It is called the Free Church of Scotland. And you're free to do what you want.
No velho cemitério de Port of Spain, hoje praticamente abandonado, muitas das campas ainda estão marcadas por nomes portugueses. Vizinha do cemitério, outra marca, a Associação Portuguesa, que foi fundada em 1910.
And they set up themselves in the old traditional practices that they observed in their home. Little shops.
Like that one?
Yes, like that one there, where they had little rum shops. So they settled in San Fernando, Port of Spain, central Trinidad in the area called Cuba, and to some extent Arima and Sangre Grande.
Foi a cana-de-açúcar com a sua sede de muita mão de obra que trouxe os madeirenses para Trinidad Tobago. No mesmo ano em que chegaram os exilados protestantes, aportaram também barcos com imigrantes católicos vindos do Funchal.
From what I understand in history, most of them came to work. So it meant that they left a difficult economic situation. And the Presbyterians came from a wider spectrum of society. From my readings, I got that you had people from all different classes. There were some literate Presbyterians, whereas most of the Catholics who came in 1846 up to 1848, they were not literate. But they were the ones who paved the way for the Presbyterians to come.
Did all the ordinary stuff, especially open up cafes, and shops and little stores and that sort of thing. It went into business mainly.
Ainda hoje existem em Port of Spain estas lojas coloridas que vendem rum, a bebida da ilha. Na altura em que os portugueses chegaram, como agora, o rum unia as pessoas e a estratificada sociedade. A música Rum e Coca-Cola, cantada pelas Andrew Sisters, foi criada em Trinidad por causa de um português, José Bento Fernandes.
How many rums were available when he was a young man? I don't know. Maybe 30, maybe 40, maybe more. All of totally variable quality. Perhaps each family putting different labels on every other month, every other 6 months, whatever. And one of his big fights was to standardize this whole thing. To make sure that whenever they collected bottles, that it was always the same bottle. So that their product looked the same. They made labels, they printed proper labels so that they always look the same, and so on and so forth. And then
he assisted all his people, providing jobs, homes, food, made sure their children went to the better school, and even a lot of second generation of the Portuguese worked for him. And what he did too, they set up rum shops. He set up people, besides working for him in the plant, he set up shops that would sell the rum, okay, around the city. And he would give the Portuguese people the rum shops to run. So they bought the rum from him and then retailed it to the man in the street. That brain, that business brain. People today go away to university to get degrees on how to do that.
In old Trinidad, I hold no fear. The situation is mighty queer. Like
José Bento Fernandes, conhecido como JB, foi o homem mais rico do país. Herdou um negócio de família tradicional português, vendeu a fundo. Mas o seu avô e o seu pai eram lutadores, não destruidores de fundo. Compravam o álcool às plantações de açúcar e plantavam-no em cascos de madeira durante 3 anos, em ação que permitiu chamar a rumo à minha vida. Foi um incêndio que deu a fortuna à JB. Em 1932, o fogo da Rua Alfândega de Corda de Espanha estava nos resultados da venda de álcool da produção de carros de açúcar. JB comprou os salvados e passou a fazer um rumo com a assinatura. Para ele, o rumo teve garrafa própria, rótulo e rolha de cortiça. O Fernandes, 1919, feito com o álcool que escapou ao fogo, tornou-se lendário. Seguiram-se outras marcas que em Trinidad se guardam na memória. Fernandes Black Label, Fernandes White Star.
Rum and Coca-Cola.
After he'd finished work in Henry Street, walk up to the hill there, and he would sit there to think, to have a cigarette, to contemplate different things. And he always said, one day, I will put my house up on that hill. And there were no houses up there in those days.
Estes barris que levam Rum Fernandes já não pertencem à família que lhe deu o nome. Depois de se tornar o homem mais rico de Trinidad, JB vendeu o Rum Fernandes à multinacional bancária.
Like so many Portuguese families, Madeiran families that came here, came with some knowledge of the Madeira wine business. And the Madeira wine business was, in their day anyway, in the 1880s, made with sugarcane spirit, because sugarcane spirit was available in Madeira. So it was not an unusual product for them. Wine, however, in the tropics, in Trinidad, became a problem with the heat and the inability to properly control the temperature. So they came with this knowledge. They soon forgot, I think, the wine part of it. It wasn't popular. It was a British colony where wine drinking wasn't particularly common.
José Fernandes deixou crescer a barba em sinal de luto por o pai ter vendido a marca que ainda hoje leva o seu nome. Agora, José Fernandes importa vinhos da Europa e dá-os a provar aos caribenhos habituados ao sabor doce do rum. Mas um dia, ele sabe, o rum voltará a cruzar-se com o seu destino.
This is a pitch lake. And the pitch lake is the biggest pitch lake in the world. And it go all over the world. You name it. Germany, Portuguese buys it, China, England, all over the world, you name it.
Em Trinidad há um lugar chamado Peach Lake, o lago do Alcatrã, uma das riquezas da ilha. Peach Lake é também o nome de um romance dos anos 30, escrito por Alfie Mendes. Este descendente de madeirense é um dos pais da literatura das Caraíbas. Neste livro, o escritor conta a vida dos portugueses em Trinidad e como ainda se sentiam na comunidade os efeitos das divisões religiosas antigas.
Pitch Lake was heavily biased towards the racial mores in the island at the time. the class and racial mores, Portuguese and how they fitted it within the class structure of the society, a little bit of sexual intercourse between different races. And that was one of the themes of a lot of his short stories too. Would it be fair to say, Uncle Dick, that my father was the rebel of the brothers in the family?
Definitely. Oh yes, he was got out of line, and he got very unpopular with the parents too.
His father.
At one time, they got very annoyed with him.
Well, his mother was Catholic, and his father was Presbyterian, and the father helped found the Church of Scotland in Charlotte Street. Anyway, he became totally atheist. He came out of that war totally disillusioned with the capitalist system. He was known to be very radical leftist. He was also against the Catholic Church. He was against the colonial powers in the island. And he rebelled. He would go into the church, the Catholic Church, and get up and start shouting things like this.
Vencedor do Oscar com Beleza Americana, o realizador Sam Mendes é o famoso neto de Alfie Mendes.
Because I don't think many people put Sam Mendes' name together with Trinidad, because he wasn't born here. He was born in England when I was studying architecture in England. In fact, I looked after him for a little while when Peter, my brother, broke up with his first wife, who was Sam's mother. And during that period, I helped, I looked after Sam for a few, I don't know whether it was a few months, I can't even remember.
The Portuguese community is there, but I think it's less close as a community than it would have been when I was growing up as a youngster. As a youngster, there was more, I think, interaction between the Portuguese families. There was more socializing that was essentially Portuguese. There was, every year, I remember myself being in a carnival band brought out by a Cabral. They lived next door to the convent, actually. George Cabral had been mayor of Port of Spain at one time. And his eldest daughter, Isabella, brought out this carnival band every year, and the bunch of teenagers, we would be all together in this band. So there were closer connections, I think, than there are today.
He was also chairman of the carnival committee, which gives you the guidelines of the things you should not do during, you mustn't sing vulgar songs, well, that's many years ago, not like now. Mustn't dance vulgarly, you mustn't dress like a man, and a man mustn't dress like a woman. They don't want you to encourage churn in the crowds in case they get hurt or see things that they shouldn't see, you know. They were very strict in those days.
It comes down a few generations. It has been lost. Because I remember my grandfather, when he came, he could not speak English. And he says, we have been kindly taken in. It was a British colony at the time. He says, we have been kindly taken in by the British, and therefore we must learn to speak English. So I never spoke Portuguese.
Embora sejam ainda frequentadores dominicais da Igreja Presbiteriana Portuguesa, os descendentes de portugueses reconhecem que hoje pouco resta das suas origens madeirenses.
If it could really be traced in Portugal, if there was any record of this Antoinette and this family, because we don't know.
If I know any Portuguese words, do you?
But I don't think that's how it's pronounced anyhow. How do you say garlic pork? It is one
garlic
of the
pork.
Things that stays with us as a
Calvinadine.
It's one of the things that stays with us as a part of our Portuguese heritage is Calvinadine.
as influências portuguesas são visíveis em Port of Spain. Mas, com o passar dos tempos, misturaram-se com outras. Port of Spain transformou-se numa cidade pós-colonial com fortes influências americanas e os portugueses dissolveram-se na sociedade caribenha.
I would ask Granny, what does it mean to be the daughter of a Portuguese? What is different about being Portuguese? And she would say, nothing. I'm a Trinidadian. Nothing special. We're just normal people. People who want to find out about their parents' origins in Trinidad, they write to me and ask me if I can help. And they ask me things like, can you help me find the marriage records of my parents? Can you help me find the birth records or the death records? Because there was enough time before the mass migration to the US for people to be born, for them to die, and for them to be married here. So people who went on to the States and who have descendants there, they left behind contacts and information which they want me to help them find. And one of them is a namesake. His name is David Ferreira, or Ferreira, whichever pronunciation you want.
David Ferreira vai seguir o trilho dos madeirenses que fugiram de Trinidad para Springfield.
We're now to Springfield, just from Chicago, not a big deal. Doing some family history research.
Interesting. Interesting. Okay. Your family's originally from where, for my mind?
Well, that's what we're going to find out. Portugal. Portugal.
Anything else for you? Interesting.
It made me, first of all, it made me weep. It made me cry because these people lived through some very traumatic experiences, and their religious beliefs were so strong and their faith was so strong that they it allowed them to go through many, many bad things, many hard times. And I felt connected to that. It makes me want to know more about these people because I think they're kind of heroes and heroines. They're like that to me, you know. And they're my family.
Para os portugueses foram estranhos o clima e a vida dura de Trinidad. Em 1848, receberam um novo convite, desta vez da Sociedade Bíblica Americana, para se instalarem em Springfield, no estado de Illinois. A família Ferreira foi uma das que aceitou o convite, e é em Springfield que David espera encontrar resposta para as suas perguntas. David chega a Springfield, capital do estado de Illinois, cidade onde viveram os seus bisavós.
Great. Okay.
Até agora, David só conhecia Springfield das fotografias do álbum de família e das histórias que o avô lhe contava dos tempos de escola.
We're here to we're in town to research my great grandfather who came here. Find out some things about our family history. So that's probably what we're going to be doing mostly for the next 3 days.
Springfield é uma cidade pacata. Houve tempos em que foi um importante centro político, mas agora está reduzido a algumas autoestradas e muitos centros comerciais. É aqui no meio da América que começa o Oeste e a pradaria. David vai começar a pesquisa sobre as suas origens com uma das memórias vivas dos portugueses em Springfield.
Hello, thank you.
Would you sign your name on my book, guest book at the door, please?
I will, thank you.
Put your name and your address on it for me, please.
Okay.
I'm going to have company from Portugal in a couple of weeks.
Oh.
There's three of you. How nice. And I can walk. When I got my walker to push it, I have troubles, but I can do it.
You're doing wonderful.
I'm 95 years old, the 31st of May. I moved in here 1981.
Oh. Okay.
And when my husband died, in 83, I said, am I going to sit around and ball the rest of my life? Or am I going to do something? And I done something. I've got all this history gathered up here.
I have some questions. That's wonderful.
Here. Now, there's two boxes. There's one on the diamond.
One
on the diamond.
And one on the Ferreira.
Now, the people of Springfield don't know they're Portuguese. And you tell them they're Portuguese. Oh, no, I'm not. Oh, yes, you are. Come here, I can show you your ancestor tree. But they don't believe me. I have an awful time convincing people that they are from the Madeira Islands. And they're the only people that were invited to Springfield. The other people have trickled in a few at a time, but they came as a group, 130 of them. The people from the First Presbyterian Church met them at the train. And there's five empty houses for 130 people, and they were empty. So they asked the people of Springfield to donate things to fix the houses, and they were very proud people. They did not want these things for nothing. They went to the people's house, cooked, squashed, sawed wood, and did things in exchange for chairs, tables, anything that they could use in their houses.
O centro histórico de Springfield ainda está como os portugueses o conheceram. Quando os portugueses aqui chegaram, morava na cidade o advogado Abraham Lincoln. Poucos anos antes de se tornar presidente dos Estados Unidos, Lincoln foi vizinho dos portugueses e há registros de que emprestou dinheiro a muitos deles. Mary Todd, a senhora Lincoln, teve várias criadas madeirenses. A casa de Lincoln foi transformada num museu, onde os americanos guardam estas memórias.
Take a good look at the Lincoln guest bedroom. Then you're going to follow me into the Lincoln bedroom. In the Lincoln bedroom, no railings to keep us on the gray carpet. We just have your good behavior to keep us on the gray carpet. Okay, follow us. Go ahead. Well, Mrs. Lincoln needed help to take care of this big house. There was no electricity, no electrical appliances, no modern cleaners. Everything was hard labor. Most of the time she had two ladies working for her. One was called the day girl. She came over once a week to do the laundry. She came over the next day to do the ironing. And sometimes it took 2 days to do the ironing because they ironed everything. Her name was Mariah Vance. She worked for Mrs. Lincoln 10 or 12 years. She was a black lady. And therefore, her husband didn't have the best of jobs because it was hard for him to get a good job. And so she helped support her husband and her children by working for Mrs. Lincoln 10 or 12 years for 2 or 3 days a week. Then Mrs. Lincoln had a person called the hired girl who lived right here in the house. Mrs. Lincoln liked to hire teenagers as her hired girl because she could train them to do the cleaning chores, train them to do it her way. The problem with that is the teenagers would grow up, get married, and quit. So there were 8 or 9 different teenage girls that worked for Mrs. Lincoln over the years. Now, we don't know too much about those girls, except that one was Mr. Lincoln's third cousin. There were a couple Irish immigrants, one Portuguese immigrant, one black girl that worked for the Lincolns. And we know this, they were all poor, and they were trying to live the American dream.
At night, Mrs. Rodriguez was the dressmaker, She'd go to Mrs. Lincoln's house, measure her, see what she wanted. They even made her underclothes, her handkerchiefs, everything. And the boys' shirts and pants, and Abe Lincoln's clothes. They made everything. And Mrs. Rodriguez would go and get the order, and then at night, all the Portuguese women would go to Mrs. Rodriguez's house, put their kids to sleep on pallets on the floor. Am I getting it too fast? I tried to slow it down. She's sleeping on the floor, and the women would sew all night on Mrs. Lincoln's clothes.
Springfield é uma cidade orgulhosa do seu presidente.
I didn't know you were going to be here.
You didn't?
I didn't.
Did you know he had all the shots? He's so comfortable. Hey, John, you go in there and have a good time. Watch out for the cows.
Nos intervalos da sua busca genealógica, David aproveita para assistir a um típico rodeio com a sua família. Em 1848, os protestantes madeirenses aceitaram o convite americano e partiram da ilha de Trinidad. Foram novamente de barco e entraram nos Estados Unidos pela porta reservada aos imigrantes, a cidade de Nova York. Nova York foi o lugar da renovada esperança para estes exilados. Chegaram os Vieiras, os Mendes, os Ferreiras, os Silvas, os Ornelas, os Batistas, os Teixeiras, os Eustáquios, os Vasconcelos e tantas outras famílias que traziam atrás de si uma história de intolerância que comoveu a América. Os americanos arranjaram-lhes guarida em Staten Island, a ilha que fica em frente a Nova York. No albergue destinado a velhos homens do mar, aguardaram a partida para Springfield, destino final. De Nova York, foram de barco e depois de comboio através da América até Springfield, onde havia casa e trabalho à espera deles. Os exilados encontraram ali um refúgio.
Majority did not talk at all about their home life or very little why they even came. They just would not even tell their children, and the children knew not to ask. So the sad thing of it is they took the story with them. This is a Portuguese Bible that was dedicated to the church, Northminster Presbyterian Church, and we received it in 1885. This Bible, along with many other Portuguese Bibles, were used in the church for many, many years by the congregation. Today it is placed in the sanctuary, and it's on display, and it's a vital part of the Northminster Presbyterian Church.
A missão de David não é fácil, mas ele conta com a ajuda de outros que já fizeram o mesmo caminho de procura. A busca genealógica é uma das manias dos americanos, como Dan Eustache, que levou 12 anos a encontrar a forma correta de escrever o seu nome.
Yeah, from Morgan County?
No, they say.
From here, yeah. I have the Morgan County census from 1850, and from of course every 10 years, I guess, and 1860, and they list Manuel Ferreira already in 1850. So he may have been on a boat from 49.
Well, I hope someone is here who might be able to help us.
Com Dan, David vai ao cemitério de Jacksonville procurar a campa dos seus bisavós.
Howdy. Hello.
Well, my name is David Ferreira.
Okay.
And my grandfather, Homer.
Okay.
And his wife, Mary, are buried out
here. Okay, let's go in where we can look at the books and... Here's where we're at in the shop.
Yeah,
so
okay.
Right down so here. It's right out here.
Right out here.
Yeah, let's go see if they got a stone.
Okay. Oh, I wish I had my camera. I can't believe I don't have my camera. Should we go out this way?
Yeah, let's go out this way.
Okay. We'll go this way. It might be a low you found it. Oh my. That's right.
Okay.
That's right. This is it. And this is my great-grandfather, and then this is Mary Martin, and I'm going to visit her nieces today. Maxine and the woman that I called today, Mary's brother, is their father. So my great-grandfather, Manuel. But he was not born in 1860. He became an American citizen in 1860. Okay, so we'll... Now, I'm wondering, I thought my... I thought Homer... I don't know where my my grandfather Homer and my grandmother, I don't know, I thought maybe they're buried. I need to find that too. But I can do that another time. I have to come down here again, probably next summer.
You're not going to get this all overnight.
Oh, no, no. I'm just getting a good start.
Right.
I'm getting a good start.
It took me 12 years to get all this figured out.
8 years. Well, I'm going to take my time. This is a great start, so I'm ready to go. Okay.
Thank you.
Uh-huh. That's Bubby. When you open your eyes, your daddy and mommy just smile. Michaela, we all love you so.
Na casa de Justina West, David encontra velhas fotografias de família.
Great, 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 great grandpa.
That's amazing.
friends who were like 80 and 85 years old made the comment that, oh, now we can actually admit that we are Portuguese, where before you just didn't talk about it, you were from the other side of the tracks or not really accepted.
Well, I imagine they're about as strong together as they are now.
you mean where we live on Portuguese Hill?
Oh, yeah. That
well,
was...
one time, nothing but Portuguese out there, but now we've not hardly any left.
You count them on your fingers.
David soube que Betty Gomes, uma detetive privada, tem arquivo pessoal em casa.
This lady in here?
Nice to meet you.
I'm here, of course, to find what Emmanuel's birth date might have been. I have his naturalization papers.
We might be able to solve that today. I do have lots and lots of Portuguese obituaries.
Okay.
And I do have a lot of information out of old session records from Northminster Church.
Right.
Now, we could look on the roll call book. We did a roll call two years ago when Northminster Church had the 150th anniversary celebration.
Okay.
And I had about 3,000 names. And Mr. Steve Todd and Chuck Bowen were the announcers calling all of those names out, 3,000 of them, in about an hour and 15 minutes.
Wow.
So this tells you how many people through the years have belonged to Northminster Church or its sister churches,
okay,
like the Jordan Street Church or the Central Presbyterian Church. They've had five or six different Presbyterian churches for the Portuguese at different times.
I understand.
Now, realize that I have read many, many newspapers. I have my own microfilm, microfiche reader in the kitchen.
Wonderful.
My own copy machine, my shredder. I have a little office here.
Yes.
And
it's very nice.
I was a criminal justice major, and consequently, that's what all that's dealing with in those books back there.
Right.
I am doing murder books on Morgan County also.
Where would you like me to do this?
You can sit right there at that desk if you'd like. Certainly.
Thank you.
Certainly. Yes, sir.
Okay.
You need some pencils? Pencils right back there.
I've got a pen here.
Okay.
So.
Do you need paper?
Yes, please.
It's right behind you. Right down below you there.
Down here.
Excuse me.
Okay.
I don't mean to be poking into you. Right here.
Oh, great. Thank you.
There
you go. Now, could I maybe I can get a copy?
Would you like to have, I'll copy it for
May
you.
I have a copy?
I'll blow it up for you.
Oh, that would be wonderful. If I could. Do you slip it out of the jacket or
No, I just leave it in.
Leave it in the jacket?
Yes.
So open the
Yes.
Okay. And then I'll pay you for the
No. I don't pay it, charge anybody.
Well, thank you.
No.
That's very nice.
And especially some of my own people. I don't do that.
Here we are on Portuguese Road in Jacksonville, Illinois, going up to Portuguese Hill, where I think my father went to school in a one-room schoolhouse, and after 2 days of looking for family, the Ferreira side, I have many, many questions, and I have some answers. So, E. M. Ferreira, who are you? Where were you born? I don't know yet. Came from Madeira to Trinidad. Which ship? I don't know yet. I know you became an American citizen, and I know who you married, and I know when you died, but we're looking like all Americans for our family heritage. So, is this beautiful country where the people came and they were given land, they were given a home by the Presbyterian Church,
And here we are searching for who my great-grandfather was. I know for 2 days I've been looking, now I know where my grandfather is buried, and my grandmother, and my great-grandfather, but his grave marking is wrong. He says he died in 1929. That's true. But when was he born? I hope I can find out. This is just the beginning of this search. And here we have one-room schoolhouse. This is where my father probably went to school when he was very young. It's been burned, but just a little bit left. I can see the roof. And I'm wondering, what did it feel like to go to a one-room schoolhouse in Jacksonville, Illinois? And I went to school, hundreds of students. And he rode his horse. I know his name was his pony, Peaches. And I know his dog's name was Queenie. And I know a lot of things, but I have so many questions. I think I'll move closer to, yes?
O Illinois, no meio da América, não foi a meta para todos os madeirenses errantes. Para alguns, foi uma mera etapa, como antes já a Trinidade fora. Alguns dos protestantes partiram outra vez. Passaram em São Francisco, na Califórnia, do outro lado do continente americano. Mas aí ficaram pouco tempo, apenas o essencial para embarcarem de novo. A Igreja Protestante Americana tinha-os chamado para irem evangelizar os madeirenses católicos que trabalhavam nas plantações de cana-de-açúcar no Havaí. Embarcaram de novo rumo a esse arquipélago estranho, no meio do Oceano Pacífico.
This is a call from Hawaii. And here we meet again beneath the mighty Moana banyan tree beside the sea. The great panorama of Waikiki Beach before us. Old Diamond Head at one end, surfboards and outrigger canoes catching waves out there. Many colors along the shore, a bright and beautiful picture. This is Webley Edwards speaking for all the islanders and for these many mainlanders from so many places whose voices now rise with us in that traditional shout that begins our songs from the islands. Our aloha, as Hawaii calls.
Mais conhecido hoje como Paraíso Turístico. O Havaí foi, nas últimas décadas do século XIX, um dos grandes produtores do mundo do sul. Estas ilhas úmidas no meio do Pacífico eram, nessa altura, um reino independente, quase desabitado. Açúcar precisa de muita nova. Proprietários dos campos, quase todos americanos, procuraram trabalhadores pesados por de fora, onde os haviam parados e com disponibilidade para trabalhos difíceis. Vai tornou-se um dos polos das rotas migratórias da açúcar, que circularam pelo mundo inteiro. Os produtores havaianos precisavam de trabalhadores e foram buscá-los ao Japão, à China e também à Madeira e aos Açores.
My grandfather worked at this plantation, and so did my father. And my grandparents came when the Portuguese was immigrating to Hawaii to work at the sugar plantations. And they had all different camps, and the camps had different names or numbers. Like there were a Spanish camp, and that's where my family grew up, lived and grew up in Spanish B camp. And it was right out here where it's one of the roads that I take to go to my office every day. It's the same road my parents lived on.
O primeiro contrato entre o Reino Português e o Reino do Havaí foi assinado em 1878. Os portugueses das zonas mais pobres do país, a Madeira e os Açores, foram levados para o trabalho duro nas plantações de açúcar havaianas. Foi a primeira grande leva da imigração portuguesa para o estrangeiro.
In the beginning, those who came worked on the sugar plantations. And the work was very hard, but it offered the Portuguese an opportunity to expand above what they could have done in their homeland. Well, the first known record of Portuguese here in Hawaii probably goes back to about 1788, and perhaps even earlier.
O trabalho nas fábricas que transformam a cana em açúcar está hoje completamente mecanizado. Longe vão os tempos dos velhos e esforçados engenhos de açúcar. Mas as plantações ainda precisam de muitos braços. Os produtores vão buscá-los a países mais pobres. Os filipinos substituíram os portugueses nas plantações de cana de açúcar.
On September 19, 1890, arrived a group of people from the mainland to Honolulu after having crossed half the continent from Illinois to California, actually originating in Springfield, Illinois, a group of people that were interested in the conversion of Portuguese in Hawaii to Protestantism instead of Catholicism.
This is a picture of the Thomas Bell, a ship which brought my grandfather, Reverend Ernest de Silva, to Hawaii from Funchal, Madeira. He got there from São Jorge, where he grew up, and sailed directly to Hawaii. After settling in Hawaii, he was 16 years old, I believe, when he came, and after living on several of the islands, Maui, Oahu, and then finally the big island of Hawaii, he became very intensely interested, or more interested, in Christianity, and became a Protestant minister.
The Portuguese who came from Springfield actually came invited by Protestants here who were non-Portuguese. They had the idea that the Portuguese were very desirable immigrants, but that their Catholicism made them less desirable than were they more up-to-date Protestantism. For some reason, they associated Protestantism with progress and Catholicism with being old-fashioned, superstitious.
Os madeirenses protestantes foram para o Havaí evangelizar os portugueses católicos. Todos juntos formaram uma verdadeira comunidade.
Ka'ulu Aloha, isn't that nice? And that's from the album Kale Momi with Gary Haleema'u. And we have a special request, so we're going to just kind of diversify a little bit over here because we have a request for rum and Coca-Cola. And we're going to get some local girls sing the song for us. But,
Melvin Medeiros é há 40 anos apresentador das manhãs da Rádio Kipa em Hilo, a ilha de Havaí.
After we play the song, okay.
Quando foi para a tropa e se declarou de origem portuguesa, o instrutor escreveu na ficha, em frente ao nome, católico. Melvin teve de explicar que ele próprio era uma raridade, de origem portuguesa, mas protestante.
If anybody could answer that, probably Ted could. I don't know. All I know is that myth, the stories that we had, was that there was a little piliquia problems in Portugal, and the Borgias, when they came to Hawaii, they were running away. But they were Protestants in Portugal, so I don't know at what point they changed. I don't know that much of the Portuguese history. At what point in Portugal did you have this, all of a sudden a group become Portuguese, and Catholic and Protestant? But I do know that when they came over here, and my grandfather, my great-grandfather on my father's side, they were all Protestants.
O Havaí é terra de misturas, e a família Medeiros não foi exceção. Ao longo dos anos, as memórias foram se perdendo, e Melvin e o irmão são os havaianos puros dos que jogam bowling e usam camisas com flores. Melvin vai ter com o irmão ao bowling para lhe fazer uma pergunta sobre o passado.
At what point in our family did he come
from Portugal?
From Portugal. From Portugal. Yeah. But mom was Catholic, right?
Yeah.
And then eventually converted to Protestant. But as far as at what point in our family's history we became Protestants, we don't know. Right?
From Portugal.
From Portugal. I just wanted to know.
All of us, I think, in the country, we all want to look for our roots. We all want to find out who we are, where we come from. And we have Portuguese culture clubs now. Portuguese people that are forming groups that are meeting regularly to explore, their heritage. We have more and more people now putting tours. They want to go to Portugal. They want to find out, what is Madeira? What is Lisboa? What is the Azores? Yeah, they want to know.
It is more difficult, to find the Protestants more so than the Roman Catholics, because majority of the people were Roman Catholics. And the Protestants, they seem to be shunned because many of them were known as bagasse. And so that terminology means like the sugar cane, it's the waste products of the sugar cane. And so that's why they isolated themselves from the Protestants. I do recall that I took out some records and even some little items for the Protestants. And I found that people would say, oh, let's not go there. That they're shunned. They don't want to go there near the Protestant records. And yet, I have people coming in here and they're checking their records. And they say, why can't I find my records? I'll tell them, you know why? You can find your records probably at the Central Union Church.
Foi a Central Union Church que chamou os portugueses protestantes ao Havaí.
This copper box is the interior of the cornerstone of the Portuguese Evangelical Church. And it was retrieved in about 1960 after a fire which burned the building. This church was built in 1896 for the Portuguese people who were here, whom the Central Union had befriended and established a Sunday school for.
I remember we suffered persecution as we went to Sunday school on Sunday
the kids, we lived in a Catholic neighborhood. Punch Bowl was Catholic. And they would throw stones at us as we went to Sunday school and called us names, called us bagasse, which is the waste of the sugar cane, and bugger sailors, whatever that means.
O bagaço é o restolho da cana-de-açúcar, o desperdício, o lixo. Era uma ofensa comum que os portugueses católicos usavam contra os portugueses protestantes que os tinham vindo evangelizar.
Because I think my parents didn't want me to learn to speak Portuguese. They only spoke Portuguese when they didn't want their children to understand what they were talking about. And that was a product of a couple things. One was, since everyone came from foreign countries to Hawaii and they were trying to meld in with the rest of the people, they all wanted to be, quote, Americans, and they wanted to speak English and not to speak foreign languages. Then the Second World War started, and there were lots of Japanese people here, and the government didn't want the Japanese to speak Japanese. So you'd see signs in the buses or bus terminals or in offices that said, speak American.
Think about it. I mean, I've never thought about that. I've always wondered why my grandfather changed his name. It was Da Silva, not De Silva. And somewhere along the line, he changed it to Anglo-Saxonize it to make it sound more, I don't know. I would prefer Da Silva. You know, that's our real name. But no, I don't, I've never thought about, you know, good, bad, or indifferent being Portuguese. You know, just, it's just me.
This is a picture of what is called the Aloha Trio. The man on the left is my father. He, being Reverend De Silva's son, they didn't have that much money, so he had to work his way through college. So he, my dad, and my uncle Lionel, and their friend Mr. Afuk, played Hawaiian music and earned their money to go to college in California.
My grandfather went into the ukulele manufacturing business with Nunes, and Nunes, and I forget the other one, the third one. And they all do, the three of them deserve credit for introducing it. But because my grandfather could sing and play it, Kalakaua was interested, and so he became a court musician.
Quando os primeiros navios com portugueses atracaram em Honolulu, além dos pobres imigrantes, traziam um tesouro insuspeito a bordo. Uma viola pequenina de quatro cordas, que na Madeira chamavam machete, e era conhecida no continente e nos Açores como braguinha ou cavaquinho. O instrumento fez tal sucesso que se tornou um dos símbolos do Havaí, e depois de ligeiras alterações, mudou de nome para ukelele. O rei Kalakaua, que governava o Havaí quando chegaram os madeirenses, tocava e compôs algumas canções para este instrumento. Na igreja portuguesa de Mindo, tocam-se cânticos protestantes ao som do ukelele.
That's a hard one, though, isn't it?
O reverendo é, há pouco tempo, Charles Sanders, um americano do Kentucky, que veio parar ao meio do Havaí. O reverendo Sanders é um antigo sargento dos Marines e ex-combatente no Vietnã. Sanders trouxe com ele as medalhas e as condecorações que espalhou pela parede da sacristia. Ao princípio, provocou estranheza com as suas tatuagens e o brinco na orelha. Mas Sanders conseguiu conquistar os portugueses descendentes dos que fundaram aquela igreja.
I knew nothing about the Portuguese people or anything like that. I mean, I actually figured the Portuguese were Spanish. You know, that's just being very upfront, because I come from Louisville, Kentucky, and you don't see a lot of Portuguese there. In fact, I was Cherokee, and we have some English thrown in there somewhere, a little Sicilian. But I didn't understand how this was the Portuguese church. I didn't know the significance of what the Portuguese people have done for this community. And as I began to learn, I realized just how vital their input has been in this society.
Jacqueline, Lucille, Doreen, Mildred e Gladys são portuguesas das famílias Pavão, Vitorino, Costa Lucas e Araújo. São das últimas a frequentar a igreja portuguesa de Hilo.
The Portuguese had their church, the Japanese had their church, the Chinese and the Caucasian people. They all had their churches.
I came in with just an aloha shirt, you know, a pair of slacks and, you know, loafers. And I look out and I see these people are very formal. They're wearing like a color-coordinated everything. If their shoes are one color, their clothes are mixed with that, and you know they don't clash or anything, and their fingernail polish and everything else. I thought, oh boy. So that was the first response. It was just a response of being underdressed or kind of out of sorts, awkwardness. Because I found that I'd walked into something that was typically very traditional, very prim and proper, and I wasn't. But they really went through a lot of struggles. I mean, to the point where they were funding their own church. They were building like a Kaiviki Chapel. I think we had just read it was built in, how many days was that? So many days by one person, 33 days or something like that. We'd read that in the book. That has to have a lot of heart there. That takes a lot of heart. So then you start appreciating the people. And as you get to know them, you find out they're genuinely nice, honest, very honest, hardworking, caring people. They're family-oriented.
Up at Kaiviki, we have a chapel that's like a little branch off this church. And that's where we were brought up. We lived up in Kaiviki. So we attended church, which the church was just across the street from our home. And so it was like every Sunday we look forward for that.
A igreja portuguesa fica mesmo no centro da pequena e úmida cidade de Hilo. É das últimas cidades do Havaí onde o turismo não chegou em massa. A vegetação tropical chega às portas da cidade que ainda se vêem restos de plantações. O sacristão é vegano. A mulher do reverendo e Sanders vão à primeira capela que os portugueses construíram nos terrenos das plantações. Agora o reverendo Sanders tem outro sonho, depois de ter reativado a igreja da cidade. Quer abrir a capela de Kaiwiki e torná-la convidativa. A capela esteve fora de culto durante vários anos. Agora, o reverendo Sanders inspeciona as obras de restauro que foram feitas. A agitação do reverendo começa a chamar a atenção dos descendentes dos portugueses que ainda moram em Kaiwiki.
You like come see the church?
No, I saw already.
You saw already?
Mm. Oh.
What are we going to do? Fix them?
Yes.
Yeah, so we can
open.
Have
first service on August 26th. 11:30. Because of you.
Good.
Because of you.
Graças a Deus por vocês come over here. I thank to God for coming over here.
O reverendo Sanders recebeu o testemunho. Ele é agora o guardião da história dos madeirenses errantes. Uma história que se passeou por mares e continentes, que começou num arquipélago do meio do Atlântico, viajou até às Caraíbas, emigrou para a pradaria americana para acabar num arquipélago do meio do Pacífico. A Terra foi um planeta pequeno para tão viajada história.